beautiful flowers for the Thanksgiving cactus, but they don't have any smell. But I guess you can't have everything. I mean, it is a beautiful plant, so I am thankful for that. But sure would be nice if it had smell, wouldn't it? It would be like this huge, huge thing with smell on it. I think that would be great. I'm going to have to get more plants that have good smells, because I like walking into the room in the morning and having a good smell. When I had the night blooming jasmine, I'd go to bed at night and I'd smell that. When I have the moonflowers blooming, I have that. And by the way, the moonflower is doing pretty good. So I'm pretty happy. I guess I shouldn't be asking for more out of this plant. It's already given me a huge plant. It's given me beautiful flowers, years and years of fun, and you guys have enjoyed it too. Admit it, you have. So I really can't gripe about it, even though I just did. Hey, you remember last week I gave away those gifts, you know, the pressure cooker, the huge light bulb, and all that fun stuff? You know one thing I forgot to do? I actually forgot to do it. I forgot to read their letters, and I wanted to do that for you. I wanted, everybody has a gardening tip that they would like to give from the established gardeners, or even from new gardeners, to the next generation of gardeners to try to help them along. And all of these are fantastic. Everybody sent in great tips. I read all the letters, and I wish I could read them all, but I can't. I really just don't have time. So I wanted to read the ones who won the prizes and tell you what they have to say to you as their best advice for new gardeners. Michael, who won the cup, I'm going to read his first. Michael says, Ray, thank you for doing this giveaway. My best gardening advice is to enjoy gardening. What a way to start, huh? That's pretty cool. As with things in your life, you are bound to run into adversity. You just need to remember the reasons you get joy out of gardening. For example, one of the reasons I get joy out of gardening is the experience of caring for and nurturing the living things and watching them grow and being able to enjoy the fruits of my labors. If you lose sight of why you garden, then it will become a chore and it will not be much fun and exciting anymore. That is fantastic. That is, I believe, the heart of why I like to garden and the heart of, I mean, the very core of what I try to help others with. And Michael actually gets it, and that is refreshing. And it would be nice if the newer gardeners would take this to heart, because I do notice, and you know, if this is how you are, that's fine if it works for you. Some folks think about gardening as work, you know, working in the garden, and think of it as something they have to do. You know, I got to get out there and I do this and all that stuff. And I think of it as something that I get to do, not something I have to do, something I get to do. I mean, you know, we all work our jobs and we're out there doing something that we may or may not even enjoy just to earn the money to pay the bills so that we can have a little bit of spare time to do the things we actually do enjoy. Some of us go on vacation, some of us cook, some of us raise a family, some of us garden. And so, you know, if you're not enjoying it, I don't know, I guess you're just doing it for the food. And like I said, I don't fault you for that, but it would be nice if somebody could actually experience the thrill that we get out of gardening just like we do, because if you could, that would be something that would just keep you doing it over and over and over again. My glasses aren't working worth a darn. I'm going to have to get contacts or glasses that cost more than $5. Okay, next one. Oh, there's no name. Well, that makes it a lot more difficult. Who are you? The one who wanted the cookbook. This is from Elaine. Hi, Elaine. Elaine's tip. Oh, by the way, I'm going to finish reading these and then I have a demonstration for you. So you're going to actually like this. But anyway, listen to this. Elaine says, my number one tip I pass along to everyone who asks me about my garden is, it's not the plants, it's the soil or compost. Before I started the garden, I started my compost. It just makes sense. It's recycling. It saves you money. It saves you money on soil and fertilizer, and saves gas getting the stuff, and saves on the garbage bill. Yeah, actually, that's true. And saves on the groceries with the harvest. Win, 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 win. That is true. And there was somebody, and that's actually very good advice, because like I'm always saying, I know I'm like a broken record, but I'm a broken record that you keep listening to, because I keep saying it's a matter of feeding the soil, and that's where it all begins, and that's what she was talking about. But she was also talking about the compost, working with the compost and stuff, and you can throw all kinds of good stuff. It's a great way to get rid of kitchen scraps. There's somebody who does some kind of video about how what we all believe about compost is wrong. And I watched that video. You know, everybody kept sending me the link. I was like, why is everybody sending me the link? Why? What do they want me to know? And I listened to this guy, and I thought, wow, you think you're right. And he does have some good ideas. I don't know what his name is, but everybody knows who he is. But the thing is that he's also wrong, because he's saying, you know, it's kind of ridiculous to throw your kitchen waste and all this other stuff in your compost pile when you could just do the natural way. And I'm like, what natural way? And he's talking about how leaves just fall on the forest floor and they compost down. Well, yeah, that's a great way to do it. That's the way nature does it. If you have 30 years, and some of us aren't going to live that long, we want to actually speed along the compost process, and we also want to be actively involved. That, what he's talking about, is passive compost happens in the forest. Yeah, if you got the forest behind your house and you got 30 years to wait for those leaves to break down, you know, that's one way to compost. But to say that, you know, what we believe is wrong and the way that we do things shouldn't be doing that, that's a little arrogant. And I don't like that. I don't like arrogance when it comes to gardening. And with Elaine and her comment, I think that's great. What we need to do is focus more on the soil, because if we're focusing all on the plants and focusing on other things, we're skipping the most important part. You got to start at the bottom to get to the top. And so that's actually very good advice from Elaine. Anybody that doesn't know about gardening, if you're listening to these tips, these are from some people that I believe have a good head on their shoulder and have a good grasp on things. You don't have to be a miracle worker. You don't have to be a genius. You don't have to have a college degree or do tours and stuff in order to give good advice. The best advice is going to come from your next door neighbor, your mom, your friends, people that have actually been out there and been up to their elbows in compost. Those are the experts. Okay. This one is from Christina. I thought it was Christian. Christina won the pressure cooker. Congratulations, Christina. Her gardening tip is keep trying. Oh, I love that. Two words that I could just emboss on my forehead. She says, keep trying. This last year I tried to start tomato seeds outdoors very early in the season under grow lights. I'm sorry. She says, keep trying. This last year, I tried to start tomato seeds indoors. I thought I said outdoors. Indoors, very early in the season under grow lights. When it came time to plant them, no matter how much I tried, they would not harden off. They would just die. Well, an old gardener told me that tomatoes need to have natural light early in their sprouting to develop their natural sunscreen. So next spring, I will try a small but cheap greenhouse that I can set up during the warmth of the day to help my tomatoes develop their natural sunscreen. You know, and that goes to the hardening off process. So many people jump the gun when it comes, let me get these glasses off so they don't look like such an old man. You know, they jump the gun when it comes to the hardening off process. They grow their plants inside, they think, wow, I got bright lights out here, I'll just throw them out in the sun. No, bad dog. That's not how you do it. You don't just throw it out into the sun, because these lights are not that bright. And I have some of the brightest lights around. And I wouldn't dare take my tomatoes and peppers that I've been growing in here and throw them out in the sun. You got to start off slow. Baby steps, okay? Baby steps. Let's go up the ladder one step at a time. You don't want to go from the bottom to the top. Doesn't work that way. So, you know, if you're going to want to cheat nature, you're going to pay the price for it. She learned the hard way. She took some hard knocks on this, and she learned her lesson. Take it slow, harden them off, which basically means increase the light gradually. It's like diving into cold water. If you don't take it slow, you're gonna dive into that cold water and have a stroke. So good advice, Christina, thank you very much. And sorry, I got your name wrong, I'm half blind. Braden, hey Braden. Braden, he says, hello Ray. My personal gardening knowledge would be to do whatever fits you best. Do what you want. He writes like I do, so it's hard for me to read. He says, do what you want to, although you'll learn from others. You are the one who makes the decisions. Very good advice, Braden. Very good advice. And that's what I tell people. I said, listen to people, get their advice, but in the end, do what feels best for you, whether it's organic, inorganic, raised bed, flatbed, all that funky stuff. Do what feels comfortable for you, because we all have our own groove that we're going to find in gardening. And he already knows this. For a young kid, pretty darn smart. Let's see. Also, if you don't like kale, don't plant it. You'll find that you will be planting things you absolutely don't want to. If you don't like it, don't plant it. Most importantly, have fun. Have fun. You have to remember that. It's the only reason that you're growing. Very good. He's actually saying everything that I feel And that's pretty good, Braden. Do what you enjoy, because gardening is so therapeutic. You know, gardening, it is found, it reduces, helps you release endorphins. And also, it calms you. It's therapeutic. It releases stress. They said something like 20 minutes in the garden releases so many hours worth of stress. And that's, you know, if you're enjoying yourself and you're not killing yourself doing it, what a way to go, huh? It sure beats popping a bunch of pills. And here's a little lesser known thing. I was diagnosed many, many years ago with depression, moderate to severe depression, and it was really killing me. It really was. And it's one of the reasons I retired. I never told you this before. And it was bad. Anybody that's ever had depression, you know what it feels like. It just feels like you're dying inside and nothing can help you and nobody understands you, and it's this pain inside your head. I called it my inner pain in my head, and I didn't know what it was because I never had depression. And I got it and I didn't know what it was, and I did some drastic stuff and I ended up in the hospital. And I decided, you know what, my life is worth more than earning money. And that's why I retired. I retired because I wanted to live. And I found that gardening makes me feel level. And I don't have to pop a bunch of pills to feel level. All I have to do is my thing. And that's why I garden. I call it dancing in the sunshine. I lose myself in this and it recharges me. When I start feeling bad, I go back to this and it brings me back down to where I should be. And it's a good thing. I'm not saying that you should treat your depression with that. I'm just saying it's one of the things that can help you with treating your depression. So keep that in mind, folks. Do what you like, enjoy yourself, and use this as something to help you, because it can help you. It's not just food, these are your friends. Okay, look at Ray, just talking down to everybody like a psychologist. But it's true, it really is true. Okay, next one, who are you? Where did I get this? Oh, this is from Jonadab. Jonadab won the fertilizer. And Jonadab has some advice for you. What, dear Ray, what I would teach is three in one rule. Oh, okay, I think I've heard of this. With your videos I've watched, there is no doubt you need to learn the watering. Yep, that's true. Watering is everything. Every plant has different needs. And that's true. Jonadab, I just actually did this in the last episode, that big honking epic hour and 15 minute episode. I talked about water, and that's true. And he knows this, and he didn't get it from my video because I had this letter before I did the video. And he goes on to say, number two would be pruning, because with a little experience, you can make your plant self-maintained. Well, basically, your plant can become healthier. And that's kind of a coincidence, because today's episode, as soon as I'm done with the next couple letters, I'm going to show you pruning and why indoor house plant pruning is going to help your plants boost them, help them get a little bit healthier, help them grow a lot faster. And it's going to be like one of these quick tips that's a good shortcut in order to boost your indoor plants. So stay tuned for that. It's coming up, and I know you're going to like it because it's a very helpful thing. And I don't think I've ever done this before, so stupid glasses. Okay, but anyway, thank you for that tip. I really do appreciate it. There are some wise people out there, and you know, these people are not experts. These people are you. They're you. They're no experts. They're just people who have good ideas, and they've learned these from experience. You guys all have great ideas. You know, you'll have one, I'll have one, she'll have one, he'll have one. Put together, we make an amazing team. Okay, this one is from World of Change. This is Wayne, a new friend of mine, and he says, thank you for being you. You are one of the four individuals who inspired me to start my own YouTube channel. Hey, cool, thank you. For my channel and daily life, I'd love to be able to help people come to the realization that gardening is not hard. Anybody can do it. Boy, am I living proof of that. It is true. That is definitely the gospel of gardening. And it can be done on a budget by improvising. That is true as well. There are so many things that you can do to save money gardening. You know what? I'm going to be doing that in the future, and I think Wayne is probably going to do that. I think that's what he's talking about. It can be done on a budget and by improvising. Financial security and fresh food are not out of reach and can be achieved anywhere. Yep. And that's another thing. I hope he gets into this because if he does, I would love to help push his videos onto people to get them to learn that because I'm going to be doing that as well. I'm going to be doing that once I move down to Iowa. I'm going to be showing how I'm going to attempt, and I've never done this before. This is a whole new door into a whole new world for me. I'm going to be doing things that I've never attempted before. One of the things is to grow almost everything that I eat in the way of vegetables. Yes. And I believe it can be done. And it doesn't need a huge area to do it because my garden is not going to be monstrous. It's not going to be acres and acres and growing all of this crazy stuff in a million different of one plant. No, this is going to be things that I actually can use. I mean, who needs a million tomatoes? You can only eat so many tomatoes and then you get sick of them. So that's kind of ridiculous for me growing a billion tomatoes. But what I'm going to be doing is growing things like carrots, potatoes, beans, tomatoes, peppers, onions, the things that we use, the staples of our diet, whether you're vegetarian, vegan, or a carnivore. These are things that go with everything that can be preserved easily, grown in quantity, and grown well. And that's one of the things that I think Wayne's going to be showing, and that's another thing that I'd like to show. So stay tuned for that. Anybody that's going to be doing that, I'm going to be interested in connecting with them because I think together we can all give out some good information on that. Okay, we're almost done, folks. For the bulb, Bella, I got your bulb packed, and I used every piece of bubble wrap I had in the house. I was running around looking for stuff, and I hope that gets to you in one piece. I really do because I want you to enjoy that bulb. Oh, okay, I just burped. This one's from Bella. Bella writes me a poem. That was really cool. I like that. Thank you. She also has some advice. She says, "Dear Ray, instead of waiting to plant, instead of writing a plain old paragraph, I decided to write a poem about how we supposedly have no time to garden. I hope you like it. And P.S. My poem should be less than 100 words. I also look forward to using your crazy light fixture, your crazy light bulb in my new grow room." If she gets chosen, but she did get chosen. But thank you. Thank you so much. And anyway, that bulb is going to grow some good food for her. She is really going to enjoy that. And I'm glad she's going to enjoy that because I couldn't get a lot of use out of it, and I'm glad somebody else could. Diana, who got the peace of mind, and that was that little telephone thing. Yeah, I forgot to do that. And she sent in the only entry. So she won the peace of mind. And trust me, it is peace of mind. It's one of those things that you hook up to your phone. And when the phone rings, instead of answering it, when you see on your caller ID, it's from Publishers Clearinghouse or it's from credit card services and you don't have a credit card, you know it's a spam call. And you don't want to have to deal with it because you got to talk to the person. And then it's a machine. It's a freaking machine that calls you. You pick up the phone and nobody, you're like, "Hello? Hello," nobody's talking, and then you just know a machine, it goes click, and then it rings on to the operator. And I'm thinking, you know what? You can't even sit by the darn phone when you're calling me and bothering me in my life. So when I found this thing, I thought it was the coolest thing. You don't even have to answer the phone. You just hit the button. It answers your phone for you, tells them where to go, and then it hangs up the phone. It doesn't cuss at them, but it just says, "Take us off your list and don't call here again." So, and it's a really, really cool thing. All you gotta do is push a button. So she got that, and her advice, the last one, is her gardening tip from Diana is, "My tip for a successful and healthy garden. Before beginning to plant, prepare a garden layout that is guided by companion planting method." A lot of people use that method. I don't, but everybody else in the free world does. Because there are plants that go really well with other plants, plants that don't go well with other plants. And if you ever do them the wrong way, you find out. "As organic gardeners, it is important to think of our plants as a community." Very good thinking, by the way. Where neighbors matter. Just like humans, plants have certain chemistry. Some get along wonderfully together, some others can't live with their neighbors. Planting the right plants in close proximity to one another can be highly beneficial, providing natural biological protections, and in some cases, even stimulate each other to grow better and to produce more veggies or fruit. And so that is good advice from Diana. And although that is my weak spot, companion planting, I don't really do it that much. I do grow some things together, like I grow lettuce underneath my asparagus because the asparagus shades the lettuce, and I get a longer growing season from my lettuce. And things like my corn, not too far from my corn, I plant my carrots. And people might think, "Oh, you can't plant carrots by corn." Well, if you go back on my episodes, you're going to find that is the time of year that I grew corn. And in between the corn,